Welcome, I'm Jon Caldara, president of the Independence Institute and your devil's advocate. Later on, we're going to talk about, well, deregistering to vote because of Trump. Why not? But before that, all the political gossip you can't handle. From the Democratic side, Steve Welchert, good to see you.
Hi, John, how are you?
I'm doing great. And you know him, you love him. He's casual today because he's golfing after this. Dick Wadhams.
John, nice to be with you.
All right, let's start over here. You, when Ed Perlmutter decided to drop out of the race for governor, this was a personal choice that affected you. You were running his campaign.
Well, yeah, I'm going to start tearing up here in a second, yeah. John. I mean, yeah, I thought Ed was the guy. No doubt.
He was the paycheck.
Well, not just so much a paycheck. I mean, no, when you're with somebody this long, and Dick knows this, they're friends. They're not just clients, they're friends. And I gave him friend advice, not political advice.
That's what a good political guy would say to me, too, if I was hiring him, too. No, we're friends. Why? All right. Why? The timing was Polis gets in, Ed gets out, and from our side, finally, could there be a destructive Democratic primary the way that our team does so very well? And Republicans were just licking their lips. This is going to be it. Finally, they're going to get a taste of dysfunction. It's going to be beautiful. Why did he pull?
Well, we still may get a taste of dysfunction. But look, 8 years in the state Senate, it'll be 12 years in Congress. That's a long time of what we call public service.
But he made the call.
He made the call again. I think he thought he could do this. I think he thought he wanted to do this. And as he got closer to actually doing things, I mean, he raised plenty of money. He raised more money than anybody in either party in this quarter. But, you know, even public campaigning, which he loves to do, became a chore. And he said, look, I want to be the happy warrior. If I'm grinding the gears the whole time for another year and a half, that's just too much life to give away.
It's one of the, there are few better than Ed Perlmutter when it comes to retail politics. I think Kaufman works really hard, but and does it. Ed just has this natural thing. When you've always said his heart wasn't in it. Yeah. I've heard hacks like you guys say his heart wasn't in it. What does that mean?
John, running for public office and the serving as well, but running, it is horrible. I mean it is tough mentally, physically, emotionally, financially. And you really have to want it. You've got to wake up every morning and want to get out there on the campaign trail to make the fundraising calls, to be in the parade, to do all the things you have to do, to take the crap you get as well. And if you don't have that,
especially now, you
can't do it.
I think mostly because of campaign finance laws, candidates don't run their own campaigns. Independent expenditure committees and 527s and C4s and other groups are running campaigns, and they sling so much more mud because if you're the candidate, you can't sling mud. It makes you look bad. They do it. So if you're running, you're going to get hit with the most personal, libelous crap ever. It's tough.
One more thing I think that maybe he ran into, Steve, is that when you're in Congress running for governor, I think Beaupre ran into this when he ran for governor. Mm-hmm. You're dealing with federal issues all week. And then you go into to a totally different environment of issues with running for governor. And I think that in itself is tough to do.
Different issue environment and also different kind of campaign rules, right? Different rules of the road, different kind of fundraising rules, different things you can do and can't do. We had to shut down an entire congressional operation and build up a gubernatorial operation on a different framework. That takes a lot of time and effort. But the real problem I think voters are going to see this cycle is that our system in Colorado is now set up for self-funders, whether it's on the Republican side or Democratic side. At $1,150 per person is all you can raise in a governor's race. You got to really
$1,150,
and half that's got to go to the general election. So, I mean, to get into $5 million, for example, takes every minute, every day, dollar for dollars, as opposed to writing the check.
Let's remember how this happened.
Yeah.
So, not only did Jared Polis enter the race, but many years ago he was the funder for Amendment 27, which set up these ridiculous rules, which made it so rich guys didn't have to follow.
Yes.
Talk about a great investment for himself. He gives $4 million or something way back then to make these rules that only rich guys can really run now. And then in 2017, he can self-fund and he'll drop $5 million, $10 million.
It's going to be 20. The first number is going to be a 2 for sure.
That well,
he'll drop this time, this cycle. He'll spend at least 20. Look, he spent $7 million in a congressional race, you know, against Joan Fitzgerald in 2008. Yeah. So that's one congressional seat, one primary. You're not going to multiply that times seven, but you got to multiply it times three or four, I think, at a minimum. So 20 there. The other guy's looking at his chops. The other guy who kind of set the table for himself is Kent Theory, right? Mm-hmm. Another guy who did a ballot issue last year to bring independence into the primary process because he knows he can't win a Republican primary. So again, you're trying to dilute the system, dilute money. Make it easier for these rich guys to run, and I think Coloradans are going to rue the day.
Well, and also now with Amendment 71, which has passed, we can't change that campaign finance silliness. We can't even expand it. We couldn't put in something that says, hey, rich guys can only put in $1,100 of their own money. That would make the world fair again. We can't do that. So we're stuck with a system, and I couldn't agree with you more. It's going to be the battle of rich guys in Colorado, and I think we're going to hate it.
And one last thing on this. I mean, in some states where they have these kind of limits, they say if the rich guys exceed a certain number, then you can start raising more money. We don't even have that in Colorado. We can't even break the cap in Colorado. Right. So that's
forget, Amendment 71 is the one that makes it, I think, impossible to change the Constitution in Colorado unless you are wildly wealthy.
Yeah.
So a guy like me will never be able to put something on the ballot to change the Constitution again. All right, let's play the game, though, of now that Ed is out and Jared's in, I don't see how Jared doesn't win the Democratic primary.
Well, I think he's clearly the front runner by money alone, if nothing else. Those are two very impressive candidates, Kennedy and Johnston on the Democratic side. And you notice that Johnston is trying to move to the left of Jared, that plan to do all renewables by 2040. Mm-hmm. And Kerry Kennedy.
The unicorns will come and spin
the wheel. I love that, by the way. But I think they both have constituencies that could make them competitive. But boy, money thing is.
But it's not just the money thing. Yeah. I think not only does Jared get the gay vote, which he will, he's going to get the Bernie vote. I think that's going to, out of those other candidates, he's going to get the anti-energy vote, and he's going to get the weed vote. I mean, those are a lot of bases to cover in the Democratic primary.
Yeah.
So even without the
we're not at all sure the weed guys actually vote. But that's
but they put money, and I think they do vote. I think I think it's turning into more of a legit thing, but. Here's the other part of it. He has something that I think Coloradans really like, which is being genuinely goofy. That this follows in a different style of Hick of, this is odd. So, great, we're going to have the first gay governor, and he's going to wear that shirt that you're wearing with a bow tie.
He also has another quality. I think he's a likable guy, too.
He is.
I have found Jared... Over the years, I don't know him terribly well, but I think he mixes with people well.
I can call him up and have a beer, and he's. But the same thing with Mike Johnston and Kerry Kennedy.
So to your earlier point, I think there's a pathway for kind of any of these people if they make a break for it. Kerry Kennedy's going to have the women's vote, which is a majority of the voters in a Democratic primary.
Oh, that's right. You let women vote in your primaries.
That's right. We actually let women run in our primaries. We let women run in the Republican primaries.
How's that working out for you?
Johnston could be the kind of the new guy who catches fire. He's the new fresh face on the scene, right? There's a lot of charm in that. You know, if you don't catch fire, you get 5%. But if you catch fire, then all of a sudden you're real. So any one of those guys can make a break for it, I think, and kind of pull away. We'll have to see how it plays out.
Now, what about Donna Lynn, though? I mean, is Hick and Hooper pushing her into the race?
He'll be pushing her in, and Donna Lynn will come in.
Well, the rumor
because when she took the office, she said she wasn't going to run for governor.
Right.
But she's a Democrat.
Let me tell it to John. So I think that this is kind of a Chamber of Commerce 17th Street candidate.
Okay.
And that'll get you a few bucks right off the bat, but get you about 500 votes. So I'm not sure how that plays long term.
Let's switch to the other side. Yeah. Because there's one thing our team is good at is destroying a sure thing. You know, Caldara's axiom, nothing Republicans can't screw up. So our mantra every year is, how do we Dan Maze it this year?
Yes.
And, I mean, we're kind of setting up for that. I guess there are a couple big ones. I think it's pretty certain that Walker Stapleton will, he's been working on that. The big question is, does Cynthia run? Does she run? I think she's leaning towards it.
Well, I hear she's thinking about it strongly. Cynthia, I think, would be kind of an instant front runner if she got in the race. Think about how many times Kaufman has been on the ballot statewide. Mike ran three times statewide.
Right.
All that TV he's done in those congressional races, she ran statewide.
And she won by Hillary won.
She did, right. But I've got to tell you, I'm not sure she would have to sustain that. And frankly, John, we've seen some front runners fall before in the state in Republican primaries. I mean, I think of my friend Gail Norton, who I respect greatly, but she had a huge lead over Allard in 96. And she didn't sustain that.
Well, let me ask you the first question, though. Can she make the primary? Because I think she would be a devastating vote to somebody like Jared Polis in the general, a first woman, now a divorced woman. Mm-hmm. This is something that connects with a lot of Coloradan voters. But she's got to get through the thorny patch of actually getting the nomination.
Well, she would have to make a very tough decision, go through that very tough caucus assembly process, which we both know is very hard and getting harder for anybody who's not on the far right in our party, and that's the brutal truth. Mm-hmm. And then, or go through the petition process, which I know from personal experience takes $250,000. Mm-hmm. $250,000 is the entry fee,
and an awful lot of time from your candidate.
It is exhausting, and they haven't changed the law, so it's going to be just.
And then
as
you also have to pay for the challenges because you didn't get enough. And
my guy last year didn't have to go to court. But anyway,
I'm such a good consultant.
It's going to happen.
Dick does not count. I've learned that the hard way, by the way. Yeah.
But it is hard. And all these guys are going to have to make that.
Who would make the most dangerous Republican candidate from your point of view?
Boy, probably somebody without a voting record, like a Cynthia Kaufman. I mean, you know, having a voting record, you know, sets up all kinds of things you can have fun with. But not having a voting record would be interesting. You might say Kent Theory to that, but Theory's, you know, fraud problems. You know, that's just those commercials make themselves.
Let's talk about that for a while. So we now have open primaries, which I don't even know how all this is going to work. But if you're unaffiliated, you'll get to choose which one you want to get into. It makes the question, why be affiliated now if you can just go where you want? And that Kent Theory bankrolled that, we think, because he wanted to run and he knew that he needed to attract non-Republicans in a primary. Why wouldn't he run?
So let's be clear about the law to begin with. Unaffiliateds can vote right now in a primary. They can walk into the polling place and say, I want a deer in our ballot, and then the next day change their registration back again. Mm-hmm. So that's never been a problem, but, you know,
they have to register as they vote, basically.
Basically. Same-day registration, which you like a lot.
So, yeah, big fan of free same-day registration.
But so now an unaffiliated voter is going to get two ballots sent to their home. Right? And you have to pick one and send it back. You can't do both. You can't cross over, pick one ballot and send it in. Look, we can't get Democrats or Republicans to vote in June primaries. I don't know why we're ever getting an unaffiliated voter to vote in a June primary.
Steve, I agree with you. A year ago right now, we had a very big Republican primary for Senate. Five candidates, all on TV, lots of media coverage. Yeah. 35% of Republicans voted in that very high-profile U.S. Senate primary.
And that's not bad, by the way.
Not bad. But still, 65% of Republicans chose not to vote that ballot that came in the mail to them.
You're right.
So it does raise the question, why would an unaffiliated voter, and you know as well as I do, Steve, what's going to happen. A lot of unaffiliated voters will get that in the mail and say, what the heck is this? Yeah. Vote in both.
Scotch in both. Yeah. And the only guys who can play that game and even try to experiment there will be a guy like Theory or a guy like Polis who has this money to burn and can go try and generate unaffiliated voter turnout.
Right. Does Theory get in?
Boy, I sure hope so. Be an awful lot of fun.
Does he?
Well, he's quirky. You talk about quirky. I mean, he's a lot like Polis, but that Medicare, Medicaid issue that, you know, you Google his name and that pops right up. And in this environment, with all the discussion of health care, I think he would have to figure out a way to deal with that.
Polis is quirky, but he hasn't ridden a horse into a ballroom yet, so I'm going to give him a little bit of a break.
You don't know him as well as I do. Any other names that we're not seeing in the gubernatorial race? I know Jack Graham was thinking about this.
He's thinking about it. He's not decided yet.
Oh, really?
And I got to tell you, I'm biased, but he was a great candidate, and if he gets in, believe me, he will pour himself, and he will self-fund, too, if he gets in.
And Graham's the guy Democrats would be concerned about because he is a good, moderate, centrist, good-looking guy, comes from not the Denver-Boulder axis. Those are all challenges, no doubt.
Do I have a shot?
You have a shot. Oh, yeah, absolutely.
We're for you. We're going to endorse you here.
That's what I need is your endorsement.
I'll either support you or oppose you, whichever helps you more.
One last small surprise. Ken Salazar and Ed Perlmutter talked all winter about not wanting to run against each other. Right. They made a decision. Ed kind of stepped out. Don't be surprised if you hear drum beats for Ken Salazar to come save the party.
Good stuff.
Somebody's got to say, we're going to come save the party. We cannot. If Polis is the nominee, we risk losing the governor's office. That's too big a deal.
Wow. Well, you heard it here first. I love right. that one.
That is a great time.
And on endorsements, yes. So when Polis was running against Joan Fitzgerald a long time ago, I looked at him. I said, tell you what, Jared, you give me $1 million to the Independence Institute, and I won't endorse you. And like this, Jared went back and said, how much to endorse Joan? Stay tuned.